So my name's James Beecher. I'm Research and Development Manager at Citizens Online. And my colleague is David.
Hello, everyone. My name's David. I'm Partnership and Project Manager at Citizens Online. And I'm trying to sort out the back end and some of the tech. So I'll be hovering in the background.
So for those of you who don't know, Citizens Online, which has been going for 20 years, we help organisations ensure that the switch to digital doesn't exclude people. We've worked around the UK, and obviously we're trying to adjust what we do at the moment because of the pandemic. If any of you are on Twitter, you can find us there. David is David_Skur. I'm James D. Beecher, and Citizens Online has a one on the end of it, unfortunately. We'll move on. Very, very briefly, what's the problem? At the moment, we know from the Office of National Statistics that 59% of disabled people who are aged 75 or older are not internet users, and that generally disabled people, about half of them are not internet users, and about half the people who are offline are disabled people. In short, those people who are most at risk of impacts from the virus are also most likely to be digitally excluded, whether that's because they're older or because they have an underlying health condition. So people are also being asked to do lots of things online because of the lockdown, whether that's registering as high risk for priority supermarket slots, doing online shopping itself, or applying for benefits to cover their loss of income, such as universal credit, which are digital by default. So providing remote support in these situations is really important. Today, we'll just do a bit more of a brief intro from us at Citizens Online. Then we'll move on to our guests, Atif and Meghan from Diversity and Ability, who are going to talk to you a bit more about remote support, making that meaningful, and some of the technical details of how to do it. And then we'll have about half the session for question and answers and signposting to further resources. So before we get into all that, we'd like to do a quick poll with you all. David will launch it shortly. The question is whether you've been doing any remote support since the lockdown began. Now, that could be in a variety of ways. We'll ask a bit more about that in a second. But have you been doing any remote support for people around digital skills?
I've just launched a poll, James. Can people see it on their screen?
Yeah, we're getting votes in. So we're nearly there. A few more to go. Another few seconds. I think that's probably everyone who can vote. We must have a few phoning in. So 75% of you basically have been doing some kind of remote support already. So that's really interesting. And hopefully we can help the 14 of you who haven't done anything yet. Okay, let's close that poll and we go on to the next slide. I just wanted to mention that there are a variety of ways that we can do remote support. So on today's call, we're going to talk about the more advanced ways of doing this. So it's worth saying that remote support can be done through very simple technologies, starting with telephones, landline telephones, or simple mobile phones. We can provide remote support in one way through those devices. Beyond that, obviously, we can get into video call services like FaceTime, which people with Apple devices, if you've got an Apple device, you can contact them through that. You can get them to show you the screen of another device, potentially through FaceTime. You can potentially do group sessions on FaceTime with up to 16 people, WhatsApp up to 4 people if they've got a smartphone with the app on, and then Skype up to 50 people you can have on a group call, potentially if people have that service. Today we're going to talk a little bit about Zoom and some of the other video conferencing tools, and there are also even more advanced tools, bespoke tools which are designed for remote access or bespoke screen sharing. So if we go to the next slide, we'd like to ask you another question, another poll, which is what you've used for remote support so far. So which of these methods have you been using? I think David will launch that poll. It's going to hopefully ask you multiple choice questions about whether you've been using phone, video call, video conference calls, screen sharing, and whether you've used remote control. And you should be able to answer as many of those as you've been doing. We're getting there. A few more answers to come in. Looks like one or two more maybe. So this is interesting. Looks like most of you have been doing support through phone calls, which is perhaps what we might expect, and not very many of you who've been using screen sharing or remote control, or even slightly less who've been using video conferencing, which is great because that's what we're going to be talking about today in a bit more detail. So thanks. Interesting to see that. We move on. So David, this is just a slide for you to talk about how we got to know diversity and ability.
Yeah, hi everyone. I'm really pleased to be joined by Atif and Meghan from Diversity and Ability. We've been collaborating with them for a good couple of years now, mainly through some of the great digital inclusion work they've been doing around homelessness and working with homelessness charities. They're also based in Brighton, where we run a Brighton and Hove digital inclusion network as part of our work at Citizens Online. And DNA, for short, the Diversity and Ability, have been really active partners in that sort of, you know, in that local collaboration work. And they've run a number of workshops for local charities, digital inclusion sessions, assistive technology, how to use accessibility tools, etc. So looking forward to hearing more from them now. And Atif, I'll invite you to share some of your work now.
Hello everyone. Thank you for joining us, Willie. I really hope it's as meaningful as it can be. So David sort of just said it really there. We've been working for the last 5 years really trying to combat anti-homelessness and the role that assistive technology plays in that. And that's been working well. I think the crisis we're all in now in terms of the pandemic has sort of highlighted the strengths of some of the approaches that have been going on behind the scenes. But it's also showed how vital they've been, really. And I suppose, in essence, that's what this work is about, making sure that those who need to be included are included. However we need to do that is the agility and, I guess, the strength of why we're doing this work with Citizens Online and David's team. So. But now there'll be a link to our website on below, which will show you loads of free technology, which we're keen for you guys to access it as much as possible. A lot of good assistive technology as well. And that's free, and we try and make that as free as possible. Our work is primarily designed to work around supporting disabled learners in higher education and in the workplace. And the team itself is made up of 85% of the team is really made up of people with the same lived experiences that we're trying to work to support around. And so with that in mind, there's about 110 of us, and Meghan is one of our digital inclusion experts, really. I'm gonna hand over to Meghan for a bit, who's gonna really guide you through the essence of how to make remote support on Zoom and whereby as meaningful as possible. It's important to sort of look at this stuff and realize that there are a lot of folks who are new to it, and it's also folks who don't necessarily thrive that well when they're working online. For all of us as people, we take a lot of strength in people's sound and intonation and pitch, and a lot of non-verbal cues that are really important about how we coordinate our communication with each other. Some of that can sometimes get lost or diluted when you're working online. And in some cases, for a lot of folks, working online is easier because it means not necessarily playing host to somebody when they're in your home. And what that feels like. So there's some strengths and weaknesses to it, and there's some processes that we're all learning together, and we're just sharing that. So I guess that's what this is about. But I'm going to hand over to Meghan now, really to talk you some of the nuances of how Zoom works and another piece of software we use called Whereby. All right, Meghan, I'm going to unmute and I'm handing over to you.
Thank you. Hi everyone, I'm Meghan, and I'm just going to talk a little bit about how we can use Zoom and Whereby to really provide support that's really engaging and meaningful for everybody that might need to access it. So I'm going to start off about Zoom, which is one that we're at the moment, and that's quite helpful because it means that for many of you, you should have the toolbar that's currently on the slides at the bottom of your screen, or something to that. So Zoom is really nice because it works by sharing a link with your lesson line. Once that link is shared, join on your session, given a little bit of support, internet connection is unstable. Given a little bit of support perhaps by you via the phone or via a document to join in your Zoom meeting. And when, once you're in that, you've got some great features that really help to make it seem a little bit more like you could be delivering your session face-to-face or in person. So I'm just going to start off by talking through some of the main features that we'll see on the screen at the moment. And primarily at the very top, we've got the little white box with four icons. This is just the basic options for scheduling meetings from within your computer. So for you, it's really great because you can schedule a meeting between you and one person or more. And within that meeting, you can then share videos and audios, various things like that. A couple of great things about this is you can let the person join the audio or join the meeting before you. So if they get there early or they're a little bit anxious about potentially joining the meeting, they can explore how to join the Zoom call if they would like to before you get there. Some nice other options that you've got are the potential to unmute videos and to share audio with each other. And the nice thing about this is that you've got a little bit more control over this. So if the person is struggling with these things, you can support them with that. What we tend to say at DNA is that whilst people are quite new to these softwares, you could always support somebody via the phone before they join these softwares. So if you load up your phone, you can give them a call and talk them through how to set up Zoom, how to join in all the meetings. If there are any audio issues, you can talk them through everything that you might need to try and help them access the software. You can also share screens. And I know this has come up a little bit in the chat already. Sharing screens is really great because it means that you can see everything that's happening on the person that you're supporting screen. And the nice thing about this is in kind of day-to-day life, if you're helping somebody to order their shopping online, you can see and guide them around that software really nicely. A couple of things to note here is that if somebody is typing in their passwords, you might be able to see this. So it might be worth just flagging that with them in advance so that they're aware exactly of what you can see, keeping that kind of open and honest dialogue with them. Chat box, as many of you have found on this Zoom webinar already, is really useful if the audio isn't working properly, but particularly useful in experiences that I've had recently for some people to pop in that they might need a break or they might need to step away from the computer just for a few minutes without having to verbalize that. Another great feature of Zoom here is the record option. Recording happens with the consent of everybody in the meeting. But it's nice because it means you can create short snippets of videos that just demonstrate how you do a certain feature, and the person can watch that back later on if they'd like to. We found that keeping these quite short and meaningful is probably the better way to go about this, just because it means that somebody's not having to watch back an hour of support. They can watch 2 minutes here and there just to support that one skill or barrier they might be trying to overcome. And lastly, some reactions. Sometimes it's easier for somebody to react with an emoji or a reaction rather than to verbalize something, and that's completely okay. They're all built in within the Zoom bar. So if we pop onto the next slide, we've got a couple of tools that will help you with assisting your learners in particular. And these are the features that I've found to be really, really beneficial when supporting one-on-one, trying to do particular assistive technology training or basic digital skills support. Primarily, you've got the option to request a remote control. And I've seen that this has come up a little bit in the chat as well. And this means that you will be invited to take control of your learner's screen. And the nice thing about this is if somebody's really struggling to access particular softwares or bits of software, that you can support them with that as if you were there. So you'd be able to click and be their mouse. So you can be their mouse all across the screen and support them through that way. The method that I found slightly more empowering is the annotate feature. So the annotate feature is built into the toolbar within your screen sharing options. So once you've shared your screen, you're able to go up into the view options at the top next to the little green bar that I'm sure you can hopefully all see. And you can annotate there. So you can put stars or little images. You can draw lines or circles or highlight things for people to follow. And this has been particularly useful lately because you can highlight where somebody might need to be looking at on the screen to find particular buttons. And this can really help to provide a meaningful digital interaction that kind of replicates what you might be giving in person. So where I would normally find myself pointing at various parts of the screen going, here's the button, or this is the thing I'd like you to press, you can elucidate that same thing using the annotate features within your Zoom window. Just one quick note on recording, just a little bit about privacy for you predominantly. If you're not keen on being recorded or don't want to be recorded, If you're hosting a meeting, the other person won't be able to record without your permission. So it's just a little note at the bottom for when the slides are shared with you later to have a look at to say, this is how you allow somebody to record. Perfect. I hope that's all okay so far. That's our little Zoom section concluded. And I just wanted to talk a little bit about Whereby next. And Whereby is a slightly different approach to meeting support. So Whereby, in my opinion, functions a little bit like your kitchen or your lounge. Whereby is a room-based platform. So you create a room and your learner or user can then join that room either by knocking on the door if you've locked the room down to keep it nice and safe and secure, or by just entering the room if you've left your door open or meeting room unlocked. People can join this room. They can also do the screen sharing and the same level of recording if you're using the paid version. But within Whereby, the free options allow you to have one room, screen sharing, chat windows for links, and you can also turn your cameras on and off, just the same as you would in Zoom. Super, so that's our Whereby really. They're both two great options for delivering meaningful support, and it really depends whether you might want, whether the learner has a preference or whether the learner is particularly used to using one of these softwares, or if these are both completely new. Whereby is quite simple. It's just a simple link to follow and can be easier to talk somebody through. So if you're not so confident talking through somebody joining Zoom, then Whereby can be a really great option for you. Definitely worth having an explore of both. So next up, we're just going to talk about some of the tips that we've sort of started to put together about how to deliver really meaningful support for somebody. I think one of the biggest things is to speak clearly. I'm sure many of you have experienced lately some internet issues or noticing that internet connection hasn't always been as stable or as brilliant as you'd like it to be. And as such, one of the ways that we can get around this is to try and speak slower with a lot clearer diction, so that if there's a less stable internet connection, somebody can at least try and pick up some of the words you're saying and highlight to you that maybe they can't hear you quite so well. The other way around that is also to pop things in the chat window. Stay calm. It may be very new for your learner and it may be very new for you as well. And I think a lot of people acknowledge that at the moment. It's quite important to note that technical problems can occur and you can approach these in a really calm way. What I've actually found is it's quite empowering for me to say, look, I know that these technical hiccups have happened, but in the same way that they might happen to me, I completely understand that sometimes they might happen to you and you can work together on solutions for how to support the learner in that situation. Any problems where you do encounter some technical issues, just give your learner a call, give the person you're supporting a ring. And you can pick up where you left off. The session won't be wasted just because the internet might be a little bit less stable. Listening, so it's much harder to use body language when you're on Zoom or Whereby, and that's predominantly because we only have this sort of small photo of our screens or each person. I'm sure many of you have seen that some people have joined meetings in their pajama bottoms with only their shirts, and that really does highlight the fact that with Zoom, the body language is much harder to read. Ways to get around this are to use sort of more active listening strategies and really to listen into the tone of voice that somebody's trying to portray something with. Notice the questions that they're asking, or whether the answers they're giving are engaged or enthusiastic or quite short or very long and engaging, and that can give you an idea of how the person is doing with the support you're delivering. Are they feeling a little bit fatigued that might benefit from a break, or are they really enthused and engaged? And next up, be mindful. It's really, really easy to lose track of time. Quite recently, I found myself just talking in these webinars for quite some time and not really knowing what exactly the time is. And that's because with Zoom, you can often get this bit of a disconnect between how somebody is delivering a session and how someone might be receiving it. So it's really important to just keep an eye on how the time is being shared between you both, making sure both of your energy levels stay up and nicely supported too, because both of you are on this journey together. It's really important that you both stay engaged and that you're both still benefiting from the session. So the next page, we've got just a couple more meaningful support tips. We've got a nice summary of these that I think we're sending out at the end. So really just going to talk a little bit more about them. Feel free to ask more questions towards the end. We touched a little bit on being open and honest. And that really is because this remote dynamic is quite new for people. It's new definitely for people that you're supporting, and it might be new for yourself as well. So try and keep this open, honest dialogue going. Things might crop up that you think, oh gosh, that really wasn't how I wanted it to go. But that's okay, acknowledge it, and just try and make the session as beneficial as possible. Keep facilitating questions, either verbally or through the chat. Both of those are absolutely fine and will help you to run the session as smoothly as possible. Preparation is quite key with these. Make sure you've got all the resources you might need to hand, whether those resources might be something that helps you to talk somebody through joining the Zoom meeting. So it might be a guide for you that you've made of how to talk somebody through it. Or it may just be as simple as having a laptop cable nearby to make sure that your laptop doesn't fail on you midway through the session. Hey, recording. We've touched a little bit on recording already. And this is just so you can make small chunks of recordings that might be beneficial to someone to watch back later. A couple of points here are just to make sure that the learner is happy with the session to be recorded, or they're happy for certain segments to be recorded, especially when there may be sort of bank details or things like that coming in. If you're providing support for an online shopping, just make sure they're aware exactly of what you can see, and that the fact that they can turn their screen sharing off or turn the recording off at any point in a one-to-one session. And lastly, stay secure. I'm sure you have all come across different stories about Zoom being a little bit less secure, and the variations in security across all the different platforms. And it may well be that particularly some people have got fears about using these softwares for those reasons, because they've read some articles. So it's really important for you to have a little look at some resources around security. And I think we've got a couple of links to share with you on those, just so that you're clued up and ready to answer any questions that you might receive. As we've touched on before, if you're using screen sharing, just explain how this works and how they are still in control of their screen, just to make sure that they're fully empowered within your session too. So those are our top tips for meaningful support.
Great, thanks Meghan. And as Meghan said, really, we've made sure that there is links to all the security discussions. And it's a discretionary discussion for everybody to just look at that stuff themselves and make their own mind up where they can and ask for support. So we've made this PDF really, which has a link to each of the provider's own security engagements and how they work. We've also done a platform comparison on the next slide, which is about the highs and lows of Zoom and Microsoft Teams, and whereby Google Hangouts and Skype. And we've done it from our perspective of what we really fight for is to make sure things are accessible, and being accessible means being free quite often. It's a reality that we're all facing. But that doesn't necessarily make it good enough. So we're always asking those kind of questions, and we've made this to show what we like about it and what we don't, and where there can be more strength around it. But what is often quite hassle-free is often quickly accessible and confident building. We're here to really, on the back of this, and as I said, this pandemic is bringing out some really interesting things. In our case, we've been delivering online support as an organisation, as a social enterprise, for about 6 years now. Some of the folks leading the way on that have been people that have had physical differences, often wheelchair disablement, etc., where it's not been easy to train people in their homes. So they've been leading the way on the assistive technology and how to get this remote support really strong. So it's good that we've been having that space, regardless of the current pandemic, to really ask the kind of questions that says, you know, as Meghan has said, what is it that keeps this very meaningful and connected to the folks who need it to be as strong as face-to-face would be? So that's really good. And we're really sort of here available for questions. I know we're gonna do a Q&A part in a moment for everybody. And we've made ourselves available on the next slide. There's even an email called Just Ask at Diversity and Ability, which is, you know, it's open to anybody to really sort of ask what help they might need over this process. And really just sort of recommend everyone using that, as well as the LinkedIn and the Facebook and Twitter. On our, which we're gonna show you after the Q&A, we've made a video, it's a 20-minute video on how to use Zoom, as well as, which we'll show you afterwards, as well as some really helpful links to assistive technology. And this is for technology that will allow people to be able to screen read. And so they'll be able to point something and maybe they don't read so well, but it'll read to them, as well as voice input technology. And technology that's free that will change the colors of the screen
to make it a bit easier to see. There's lots there to play with, really. But for the moment, I just wanted to use the time to hand back to David and James to talk about where we do the Q&A.
Great, thanks, Atif. Just to mention one thing which we've had someone ask a question about, there was a slide there which talked about the pros and cons of different platforms, and one con of Zoom is that it can't do subtitles. The way that we've got around that today, as you can see, subtitles, Karen's highlighted this, is that we're screen sharing from PowerPoint, Microsoft PowerPoint, which enables you to have live subtitles. This is something that I learned from DNA at a previous session. And so because we're sharing that screen, Zoom is therefore showing you the PowerPoint subtitles. So there's usually a workaround when a platform itself doesn't provide subtitles. If you use Microsoft PowerPoint, you can get subtitles to people. They're not perfect. They're really impressive given their live automatic subtitling, but you'll notice there's a few things, particularly for people who aren't the person sharing the screen. So they're slightly better for David than they are for me, for instance.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
You're muted, David. I can't hear you, David, at the moment. We can see your subtitles, but we can't hear you.
Sorry about that, James. Can you hear me now? Sorry, everyone, I'm on two computers. Had some tech issues this morning. Yeah, I think Google will also have that feature if people are using Google Docs and Google Sheets and rather than PowerPoint. So you can also do the live captioning using that.
So should we come to some of the other questions? One of the things I forgot to say when we did our second poll was if you've had experience of doing remote support, particularly if you've been using Zoom or Webby or some of these conferencing tools, we'd like to hear about that, and we can perhaps call on you to talk about some of your experiences. Patrick, you had something you wanted to say about how you've been using Zoom.
Only, hopefully you can hear me, by the way. Only that we've been using breakout rooms within Zoom for the first time. So my prime reason for setting up sessions with some of my digital learners has really been from a social point of view. There's lots of older peoples, lots of them living on their own and socially isolating themselves. So they're not getting out, they're not speaking to people. So I've been setting these up just so that people can have a chat. But Tuesday of this week, we had one of our learners had a question about how to do something on our iPad, and I was able to just quickly set up a breakout room within Zoom, which let me put Marion and James into that room. They could discuss it without disturbing anybody else who probably didn't have the same questions anyway, and then they could come back to the main meeting, and it just worked really easily.
Great, thanks, Patrick. David, could you just stop screen sharing for a second so we see everyone's faces?
Yeah, I was just about to get into gallery view.
Hi, everyone. Check in on energy levels. Are you all still with us? Thumbs up. Yeah, everyone's still with us, great. So the next person I was going to come to was Karen. You had some interesting reflections on using TeamViewer for remote control of someone's screen.
Yeah, I was just sharing that I have used TeamViewer as a remote control with someone I know well, and it was really useful for, they were trying to sort out their printer and we were talking through it, but they were missing a step. So I could take control and sort it out. But I wouldn't use it, I suppose, as a teaching tool, because it does, as I think was said earlier, it doesn't really empower the person because you're just taking over and doing it, which occasionally might be useful. My big concern about it really is there's an awful lot of trust issues there. You have to know the person really well because they have control of your computer and could do whatever they like, really. And it's very simple with TeamViewer, which is great to set up. You don't need lots of kind of, you know, technical data and information, but therefore is a bit of concern around it for me, for using it as a kind of teaching aid with learners. So I think for specific situations where you do just need to go in and sort of setting, and they can see what you're doing and you've agreed that, fine. I hadn't realised you could do it within Zoom actually, so that's quite useful to know if you, if they really are stuck on a bit. But I personally found for a teaching tool using the screen share, so I can see what they're seeing and then talking them through it, is the kind of best way for me. But I think it really does, with all of this we're learning, it depends on the learner and what they've got and what you've got. But just concerns.
Yeah, that seems really accurate to us. I think, you know, one way to get around that issue, if it is with someone you trust, you could potentially do it the first time with them, and then you could ask them to share their screen and show you how to do it again. That's often a way that we do things when we're working face to face, so no reason we can't do that online. So a lot of people have put in some of the things about security and privacy with Zoom. We've got a lot of kind of questions around that and stuff around volunteers having concerns on that. I've shared one link from SCVO, the Scottish Council for Voluntary Organisations, which I just saw them put out this morning, which to me looks like a really balanced and useful way of talking about Zoom. But I wondered if anyone else wanted to talk about experiences of being able to reassure learners, or where they're at with their understanding of Zoom and privacy. Doesn't sound like we've got everyone. Atif or Meghan, do you want to say a little bit more about this?
Sure, I'm very happy to talk about it. So within some of the Zoom options, actually recently they've put in a new tool that you can add to your toolbar if you go hunting in the Zoom settings options of your account. And this will allow you to change a couple of the security options in front of the learner. And this can be really helpful because it can just reassure both of you that this meeting is encrypted. A couple of the things are about the Zoom bombing that have come up on the news. Those can be quite nicely prevented when you're setting up your meetings. So if you set up your meetings and ensure that you've got passwords, and ensure that you can, if you are using a meeting for hosting several people, that you choose to only be allowed to let certain people in, like you did, like before this meeting, you sat in a waiting room, and then I think James or David let people in. Doing that will just make sure that you keep that meeting locked down to the people that you'd like to be within that meeting for you. And I think those tend to be my experiences of using security settings within Zoom. It's been fine for me. I've never experienced any of the Zoom bombing type of things, but all the meetings I have been in have all been password protected or have used waiting rooms. So I would suggest potentially utilising those features when you set up your meetings or calendar events.
Anything to add, Atif?
No, really. I think it's important everyone's diligent. I mean, it's a bit like how we buy anything on the internet, you know, to essentially take the responsibility of looking at it carefully. And Zoom is no different. But as Meghan said, it's really important that people register beforehand and just follow the guidelines. I mean, there's a lot of scaremongering as well that's been going on as well, which I think has to be said. And that plays on a lot of our vulnerabilities. I haven't really had a problem personally, and I was at the organisation, but that doesn't mean it's not there. So we're just exercising the diligence where we can. Just make sure everyone registers and you know who's joining your call.
Yeah, I think it's worth, I mean, my perspective, possibly our Citizens Online perspective, is that privacy and security concerns can be a real turnoff for a lot of people in terms of their access to the internet more broadly. So it's really worth trying to reassure people where you can, but also to treat their concerns seriously and try and address them through open and honest responses, as Meghan was sort of talking about earlier. So one of the things that we might want to talk about with Zoom, for instance, is encryption. There's been a lot of chat about this. The calls aren't fully encrypted, but they are encrypted for third-party users. So someone asked a question about whether Zoom has control of the intellectual property, and that is the area where it gets a bit more complicated. But the important thing is that no one else is able to unless they're on the call, and you can prevent that through the passwords, as Meghan said, no one else is able to intercept the information that's going through the call. There is that level of encryption. What was the other thing I was going to say about this? I've forgotten. But yeah, please do have a look at that link from the Scottish Council of Voluntary Organisations. We'll share that along with all the slides at the end of the session.
James, just to add to that, the question around security, for those of you that are really concerned about that, there are some alternative platforms that are coming to this space. The latest one that's being shared around these sort of networks is, I can't quite pronounce it, but it's meetjitsi. So it's meet.jitsi. I'll put a link in the chat, but that's got lots of security measures in place from the off. And some people are turning to those more secure platforms, if that's a concern.
Yeah, so just a few other things around this registration. So the system that we've used today is to use Eventbrite for registrations. And we've done that because we're quite used to using Eventbrite and we like some of the functionality it has and that we can link it to Facebook. But Zoom, as someone's pointed out in the chat, does provide its own registration system. So that's something that you can use as well. Casper, you've mentioned that the breakout rooms, which Patrick was enthusing about being useful, can't be used with screen share at the same time. So these are two really useful things to use, but you can't use them both together, Casper's saying. Someone else has pointed out, Chris Hogg has pointed out, that TeamViewer, and I think this probably applies to some of the other remote control services as well, are blocked by some internet service providers. So you'll need to check and find out which of those you can use before you start using it with different learners. We've got an interesting question here from, I'm not sure how to pronounce your name, so I hope I get this right, Malathy. You've asked for any suggestions on how to work with people who are both digitally excluded and have got English as a second language.
Actually, we work with people who have got low digital skills or no digital skills at all, and also delivered ESL classes or very basic conversational English class. And now, and we also deliver our expertise is on welfare benefits and people who are on food poverty. We also run employment job clubs. So it's very difficult at the moment to engage with people who have got both low digital skills and also having ESOL needs as well. So is there any suggestions or some tips from other Citizens Online centers for us so we can help more people?
So I've just shared in the chat. So Citizens Online is one organization. We're part of a program called the One Digital Partnership, together with Digital Unite and some other organisations who are going to be presenting in our future weeks. And one of the pages on the One Digital website is about supporting people who have English as a second language. We've previously run a face-to-face session around that. And one of the things that came up were things like helping people to do three-way calls so that a translator can be on the call. I'm trying to remember other things that just point at signposting people to services that are doing online translation, like Google Translate. I'm trying to remember off the top of my head any other quick things, but that's the sort of material that's on that webpage. I don't know if Atif and Meghan, you have anything from your experiences.
Yeah, I mean, just to add to that as well. We've done some, I think James is on this call as well, but we've done some great work with some Mongos, they have as well, on supporting ESOL learners, in the recovery college and crisis as well. That's been going on. Some of these dynamics are going on for the last 5 years of teaching technology and assistive technology in particular, but in the context of disablement, disabilities and second language changes, particularly on neurodiversity, which comes up more than you think. How folks are working on that online at the moment, I'm still not sure. I think we're still been at this flight or fight stage of trying to get people online, but I think we've got to do it would be interesting to host another day specifically dealing with that and seeing what relationships and what people are being able to do in the weeks ahead. Particularly if I think about the work that the Brighton frontline anti-homeless workers are doing
so much about that. It's been about food delivery and keeping people going. But there has to be that measurement that says, how are we keeping people communicating with each other online where they can? And I suppose that's a whole set of priorities. I would like to see how we pick this up, really. But I don't know if anyone else has got some good examples also to share.
It's probably something we could come to a particular session on in the future. We could focus on English as a second language, and we could focus on some of the communities where that's likely to be an issue. So refugees, migrants, asylum seekers. Mm. We could do that another time, and we could get a specialist organisation in who's been doing more of that work. I think we're going to need to start to wrap things up. There's a few questions I can respond to fairly quickly. So Christine Thomas has asked if we're involved in assisting people to have GP appointments, and that's we've been in touch in Systems Online with a couple of GPs or social prescribers. It's something we're interested in. If anyone else is doing any of that work, perhaps you can talk about that in the chat. And then someone else has asked about the payment for Zoom. So at the moment, I think if you sign up for an account with Zoom, if you register for an account, even if it's just a personal one, you should actually get unlimited access. You can have long meetings. But if you want to be sure you've got the full functionality, they've got quite a good offer on at the moment for charities. I think it's in the region of £50 a year. David, you probably know the amount.
Yeah, so if you through Charity Digital, they provide lots of discounts for any digital or tech tools for charities. They've got a deal of £52 a year, which gives you the pro license. Difference with the free one is you get unlimited meeting times, you get added features. I think the free one you can have up to three people in a meeting for 40 minutes. This gives you unlimited access in terms of time, and you get up to 100 participants for virtual sessions like this one. This is from a pro package based on that Charity Digital offer. If you want the added feature of webinar functionality, so a bit more just better moderation for very kind of tight webinars, then you have to, that's an add-on. You don't get that with a pro license of £52 a year. The other option is GoToMeeting, also offering three-month trials for frontline service providers, very similar to Zoom, a little bit clunkier, but we use it for work too, and it's good for virtual sessions and webinars. And one last point on tech tools, there's a question around other options. The more lightweight options like Whereby, which Meghan talked about, but also Hangouts and Jitsi. It's true that the advantage of those is there's no downloads needed. You just click, it's just on a browser. So it's probably slightly more easy to access. So there's other options out there which might be easier for some service users.
And we've had one person, I'm sure there's lots of others. Melissa has mentioned that she's been using FaceTime, and for people who are using Apple devices, that tends to already be on devices. So it functions a little bit like some of those others where you don't need to do a download. Okay, so if we go back into the slides, we'll just give you a few more resources. Thanks everyone for great questions and great comments in the chat. Apologies if we've missed any of those. Do keep responding to each other, because we'll download the chat at the end and we'll share a sort of lightly edited version of that with you all afterwards. So if anyone's got any resources to point to, then you can see those. And just the first resource here is a single image which we'll send as a PDF from DNA. This summarizes those points that Meghan was making about delivering meaningful support, which were on two slides earlier in the presentation, but are here collected on one single sheet which you could perhaps print out. We've then got the DNA resources page, and at the very end of this call I'll just get off the screen sharing of David's PowerPoint and we'll go and show you this live as a website, because it's really impressive to see the amount of resources there. The next slide is something from us, Citizens Online. We've got a page of coronavirus support resources. We've already mentioned this if you're on our previous call. This is all sorts of resources that are useful for all kinds of people, whether they've got low digital skills or actually for you yourself as someone who's looking for instance, video conferencing information. We've got a section on that there which gives guides to Zoom, as well as some kind of more generic soft skill information around how to run remote meetings using any platform. Lastly from us, we have a blog post specifically about taking your first steps online or helping someone to do so. It probably is more directed for someone who's already online a little, but it should give you a good idea of some of the things you might want to be thinking about when you're providing remote support. David, do you want to do this one?
Yeah, just for the, I know there's quite a few of you from Brighton and Hove. Just so you know, we've got a COVID-19 sort of resource page on our digital Brighton and Hove signposting website. It's being updated weekly. It's got all sorts of information about where service users can get remote digital support. We're just putting that in place as we speak, but also support for community organisations and charities that are looking for just advice and guidance around pressing digital needs, as well as all sorts of questions and answers regarding where to find the cheapest tablet or smartphone deal, how to get cheap or free internet if you're lucky enough, and so on and so forth. So please check that and join our mailing list, because we're sending weekly updates as these things are moving very fast.
So next time we'll be joined by Digital Unite. So I'm just going to hand over now to Kathy, who can hopefully tell you a little bit about what they'll be talking about next week.
Hi, thank you. Can everybody hear me? Am I in the right place?
You're quite quiet, Kathy.
Is that any better?
That's better, yeah.
Okay, I'll try and speak close. As all our organisations who've been working in this space for a long time have tried to create as much help and support as we can for organisations. We've pulled together some of our guides, which are around health or remote working or having fun online as well. And we've also provided a link where you can have those guides embedded in any organisation's website for free, if that's useful to you. We're also giving away some free licenses for individuals and small charity organisations if they want to do the training that's in our Digital Champions Network. And if we go to the next slide, we have just created our first guide for remote digital champions. It was really helpful to hear all the advice today. I found it a really useful session, so thank you very much for sharing everything. And we are starting to build a suite of resources that hopefully will also help people give remote championing support. And also, we are very happy to answer any questions anybody's got about digital champions or supporting people with our own experience that we've had over the last few years. So next week, I'm going to be sharing a bit about what we do, a little bit about the softer skills, and those getting people to take those very early steps about the hooks that might be helpful, and also share some feedback and stories, insights, anything we have from the front line of people actually doing it as well, and also be really interested to hear other people about the challenges or the good news stories too. So I hope that is that enough.
That's great, thanks Kathy. You should all have had a link to register for next week's event in the email that we sent out about details for today, but we will send that around again when we send the slides to chat and the further resources that we've mentioned. So I think that's everything. Thanks very much, everyone. We're a little over time, but we did pretty well. I hope you've enjoyed it. Perhaps if we stop sharing the screen, we can just see you all and have a nice wave goodbye. One thing we did last time was just ask you to put in the chat one thing that you found most useful today. So we'll give you a little bit of time to do that. And perhaps if anyone had any last questions, they could unmute and ask them, and we'll try and deal with that as we get some quick feedback on what was useful for people. Anyone?
And a big thanks to Atif and Meghan. Great to have you join us this week. A really helpful session. I found it, learnt a lot, especially around the inclusion aspect and thinking about your learning environment, as well as the practical tips from Meghan. So thank you very much, and look forward to collaborating more.
Thanks, David. Thank you, James. Thank you for having us.
Yeah, it's been great. Thank you very much.
Right. Thanks everyone, we're starting to see people leave the call now, so that's great. We've got, thanks for putting some chat in there about what's been most useful to you. But we'll close today's call, and I'll hopefully send the recording around with you later as well.
Thank you.